Committee meeting to order at 6:19 p.m. on Monday, June 8th, sorry. Can I have a roll call? Oh, okay. We're going to first check to make sure that we're recording. So talk amongst yourselves. Is he? Okay. We have a roll call, please.
Ms. Chow?
Here.
Ms. Rebekas?
Here.
Ms. Garrison?
Here.
Thank you.
So the first, just for everyone's information, I think we're going to take public comment after each discussion point tonight, along with each topic, but we'll start with our action items. So the first action relates to minutes. We have a motion to approve the minutes of the May 11th, 2015 Board Finance Committee meeting.
I so move.
Second.
Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rebekas?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Okay. The second action item is related to the steam table purchase at Shute Middle School. Is there any initial setup or do we...
I could just quickly mention that these steam tables are over 20 years old, but toward the end of the school year, they fell into serious disrepair, and it was at that point where the vendor told us they couldn't get parts for it anymore, and it's unable to be repaired. So we are asking for the use of bond funds to replace these tables before the start of school. And also embedded in this memo is some good information that we are applying for $50,000 of grant money to purchase kitchen equipment. And if that grant money comes in time, we will be able to use that to purchase these steam tables. But should it not arrive in time, we do have to have steam tables for the start of school. So that's what we're seeking board permission.
And the bond funds are those that we already issued the additional amount that was not already allocated?
Yes, there's almost $500,000, yes.
And I just had a factual question. I wasn't familiar with Fund 64.
Oh, Fund 64 is the fund where we put bond proceeds that we use for capital projects. So if you look in the budget document, we can show you that later. Fund 64 is where we pay for things that we're buying, like the roof.
It's a fund of ours.
It's a fund of ours, yes. It's instead of the education fund or transportation fund, it's one of our capital funds, and the number is just Fund 64.
I was going to ask if the 64 had any significance.
Not really. It's
no.
A number.
It's a number. Okay.
Does anybody else have any questions?
I just have one quick question.
Yeah.
So it says if we get the grant, it's $50,000, and then we'll also replace King Arts?
Correct.
So are there any other steam tables that also need to be moved? No.
Well, our middle schools prepare their own meals and for serving. So we intentionally had already asked the board for $25,000 to replace the Haven tables, so that we have approval for, and the grant we would use for King Arts and Shute if we can get the funds in time. They're all equally old. They're over 20 years old. Jordan, do you have anything more to
we
add?
We did Nichols steam tables 2 years ago.
Okay.
So that's King Arts.
So this is the last. These are the last.
Yes, the last, yes. For a good 20 years.
Okay, for 20. All right, if there are no other questions, then I'll make the motion. The Board Finance Committee recommends that the steam tables for Shute Middle School be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015. That would be later this evening. Is there a second?
I second the motion.
Okay. Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rebekas?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Okay. So moved. The next item relates to the Lincoln Stormwater Project and the bid reduction, or rejection, sorry. Mary, do you want to recap where we are?
We have Tom Richlick here, the civil engineer, who joined us also on the June 1st working board meeting to kind of recap where we are. We were disappointed in the lack of experienced larger contractors who responded to the bid, and also with our bid numbers coming in well above budget. So we are asking that we rebid the project late fall, probably in November, in the hopes of securing more bids from larger contractors and hopefully seeing numbers within budget.
Okay. And we did talk about this at some length last week at the board meeting. So are there other questions that anyone might have in addition to what was discussed last time? Is there anyone from the audience that would like to speak to this item? No? Okay. All right. And just to be clear, we want to make sure everyone knows we are moving forward with the project. We do have the funds. They've already, the debt services, we've already allocated the funds. We already have the funds. It's a timing.
Yes, yes. We have cash, and the board has approved $733,000 for the project, including professional fees and related costs. And we are proceeding to get the permits for the project. We need those from the City of Evanston and the MWRD. So we are going ahead securing the permits with the idea that we will be having a bid to bring forward late fall, early winter.
And just related to that, Mary, because we did have some discussion last week as to if we go to bid again for late fall, possibly doing some work before this school year ends versus all the work over the summer. How do you see that decision whether any work could happen in the spring or in the winter?
I'm going to defer that to Tom Richlick, okay, our civil engineer from Gewalt Hamilton.
Just so we're clear on how that.
So Tom, can you kind of go over what the timeline would look like and the advantage that a contractor would have in having more time to get the project done?
Of course, thank you. And good to see you guys all again. The majority of the contractor's work in most, like, you know, heavily populated areas is between June and September 1st, Memorial and Labor Day, primarily around the school calendar. And so the contractors that are qualified for this job would, if we were able to open up some of that timeline to work outside of that spectrum, we'd find some lower prices. So that would be a one opportunity to get out of budget. I know there's obvious concerns about working adjacent to schools. I think I spoke to Mary or someone right after the board meeting last week. If you go 10 miles south, you've seen everywhere else working right up against the construction fencing. If you go 10 miles north, you'd never see it. So it's just a matter of if we can open up a calendar that would allow them to do some work in March and April, recognizing that if in those times it's usually wet, rainy, you're not using the grass area, that would provide an opportunity for some better pricing. If that's an opportunity, but generally speaking, just bidding it at that early time, as we talked about last week, should give us some better better pricing, but as Mary identified, probably more comfortable and larger, more qualified contractor pool for this kind of work. So I feel like I'm like watching.
Yeah, I just see, it's like that TV show where you can't only see over the fence.
Yeah.
So I think one of the things I kind of heard us talk about last week is making sure that we engage the Lincoln community, including, you know, the staff, teachers, and others, in what the trade-offs might be if we were to try to do some work during the school year, and obviously make sure that we're mitigating, and there's no, you know, risk to students, et cetera.
Correct.
So that would be part of the process going forward. Is that correct? Just so we're all on the same page. Yeah,
yes.
Okay. Great.
And Candace, if I could just reiterate, I think a big takeaway that I had, and I think we touched on this briefly last week, is bidding in the fall timeframe for work that we know we're going to do, you know, the spring and summer. Because that is a big change from what we've done in the past, and one that I hope we can use going forward so that we avoid this sort of situation in the future.
So we'll have to look at calendaring and that kind of stuff to make decisions on capital projects earlier so that can happen, and work through that kind of over the summer so that we lay it out appropriately. I remember having gone to the ISBE conference last year, and it was one of the recommendations around, you know, in this very cost-constrained arena before the holidays, try to bid things. So it's corroborated by other sources.
Yeah.
Tom, is it fair to say that there's a potential to have reduced overtime costs if we do it the way we're planning it, rather than squeezing it into the summer months?
Yes. Mary had a chance to talk to one of the bidders and identified that there was a good, a small percentage, not a huge percentage of that, as a tight schedule between when we could award it and when we expected sod setting. If we open up that calendar, yes, you can at least comfortably reduce that overtime cost. But consider again that this, if the same contractors are all trying to fight to do their work between Memorial and Labor Day, even with overtime costs, they're fighting to get their other jobs done. So one of the two are going to bear the weight of that overtime or probably split. So, yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Tom. There's no other questions, then I'll call the item. The Board Finance Committee recommends that the Lincoln Storm Water Project bid rejection be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015.
Second.
Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
All right. Thank you. So the next action item is transportation hazards approval. Mary?
Sure. The board does see a similar list every June, and these are existing hazards, and we're just saying that they are still in existence. We did remove some outdated ones, so the list may look a little shorter to you. It's not affecting any change to transportation services, so it's just an updated list of hazards on record. So we need board approval of the current hazard list. And I'll field if there are any questions on that, and then I'm going to go into, we have five new identified hazards, if there's no questions on the current list. As we've been reviewing transportation services, which has been quite an involved commitment, you know, reviewing corners and intersections, traffic counts, walk routes, bus routes, we've identified five hazards that fall under areas we're currently busing, but we feel we need to have these on record. Which allowed the district to submit those transportation costs to the state for reimbursement. So it's not changing or adding busing services, but really applies to transportation services we're already providing. We just want to have these on record. And it came to light as we did a very in-depth search recently. So we'd like these five new ones approved. And the process, if the board approves them, is they then go on to the IDOT, the Illinois Department of Transportation, for a review and hopefully their approval. And then if we get their approval back, these would be five hazards that would be added to the new list next June.
So would we potentially be gaining reimbursement money if they're passed?
No, because we're already providing busing to students affected by these areas. And there are some hazards on record for these neighborhoods and some that are not on record. So this would be an official record, but we're already applying for reimbursement from the state. And we get very little reimbursement from the state. With the millions that we spend on transportation, we get about $40,000 back for regular transportation services. It is extremely little, but every little bit helps. So we'd like to add these five on record that certainly are true and existing hazards.
Are there any questions about the new hazards? Existing hazards.
Go ahead. Go right ahead.
Oh no, my question was not as much about the new hazards. So you said that you've already taken some that were considered hazards last year and have taken them off the list?
There were some hazards listed for Haven when Haven used to host fifth grade students, so it was a lower grade level of students. We no longer bus to Haven and we don't have fifth graders at Haven, so those were removed from the current list. It doesn't affect transportation for any students.
Oh, so that's why it doesn't matter.
Right, and there was one on here for Oakton. It's no longer Oakton's attendance area, so we just took it off because it didn't apply. Okay. But what we took off does not affect transportation services to any students.
Okay.
And some of these have not been updated for years.
30 years.
Right.
Claudia.
I just wondered, with the new ones that you've identified, will that increase our transportation costs further?
No, because we're already providing transportation services to children in these areas. It's simply providing a record that these five areas truly are hazardous and they're in existence now. So it's just updating our records.
Okay.
So when I see the submittal, it asks us to list the approximate number of students that we use. That
yes.
Mm-hmm. I guess can we follow up and then find out how many actually do it?
Well, we will be, and we are changing our process for bus transportation services in that everyone who plans to use bus service is going to be required to turn in an application for that service. So we will be routing off of returned transportation applications, and that is something new. And we can, with these numbers came from students eligible in these areas.
Right, so my question is, here's the projection. Can we find out, once the school year starts, how many actually will be doing it?
Yes, we can. We can.
You're going to have, when school year starts, you'll see 16. Is all 16 taking it, or is it two or five?
Yes.
That's all.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll go ahead and vote on this. Were you, Dr. Gorm, were you going to say anything related to?
We were going to talk about transportation later on in the transportation update.
Ah, oh, whole separate item. Okay. Then the Board Finance Committee, if there are no other questions, recommends that the transportation hazards approval be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015. Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Ricketts?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Thank you. And now moving on to the prepayments, which is item six, the Click Insurance Renewal Premium Prepayment for FY16.
Yes.
The tongue twister.
We have good news, and we do have a typo here we're very sorry about. So for our Click and our self insurance renewals, both came in under what we paid last year. So we saw decreases to our Click insurance premium. Click provides us liability insurance, workers' comp, student accident insurance, and the like. And the reason is the same in both instances. The pools as a whole had very good years, and District 65 had a good year as well. So therefore, we're seeing reduced premiums for both Click and self. The Click renewal, we did budget the Click renewal in this year's budget, so it's not being paid from a surplus. The Click renewal was a planned prepayment that was included in the budget. So we are asking that the board allow us to do that prepayment in June, except for the portion that relates to Park School. We can't prepay cooperative expenses for PARC because it's a separate budget. So those expenses we would make in July, and that's why it says payment in June and July.
Okay. So I'm hearing you correctly, that we budgeted in fiscal year 15.
Yes, we
to
did.
Do the prepayment.
Yes, for Click and for self.
Mm-hmm. Both of them. Okay, great. Are there other questions about the Click prepayment specifically?
Just a question about what fund that the prepayments come out of.
80, the tort fund.
Thank you.
Anyone else? No?
Justin, yeah. A question that on page 27, you say that it's a decrease, but then we talk about it as if it's an increase. And
that's our typo. This sentence was from last year's memo. We did not update it. We intended to update it and say we have good news here because our claims were lower. We're seeing a decrease in premiums.
Great.
Which is a good thing.
Well, can I ask, this might be a silly question. I'm curious because we've been in Click and with Self for so long. Are those only options?
They are fantastic options. They have numerous school districts as part of the pool, so we get broad coverage at pooled rates. And we did quite an in-depth search a few years ago, and we found the coverage we have with both these groups couldn't be duplicated elsewhere at nearly the cost. They're very healthy cooperatives with strong cash balances. They do refund when they have a buildup of cash. The refunds further offset our premiums. So we are not recommending a change, but we did an in-depth look a few years ago.
Do we ever have to bid it out?
We do not, because it's a cooperative purchase. We don't have to bid this sort of a purchase.
We actually had an on-site consultant who came and reviewed our options, including Click and Self Co-op, and she came back, and I believe we still have this report, that this is the best option primarily because of our experience and number of times.
Oh, I have neglected to ask anyone in the audience for these items if they wanted to speak. I just assume not. If you do want to speak on any of these items, please let me know. Okay, so if there are no other questions on Click, we'll go ahead and do that recommendation. The Board Finance Committee recommends that the CLIC insurance renewal premium payment for fiscal year 16 be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015. Roll call?
Second.
Ms. Chow?
No.
Can't.
Oh.
Yes, to me.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Roll call? Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Sorry, we have a second. She has?
Yeah.
But thank you, Glenn. Okay, self-workers' compensation, it's a similar story.
Similar story. The pool had a fantastic year, very low claims, and our district did have a better-than-usual year as well. So we're seeing a decrease in premiums and very excited about it.
We need those decreases. Any questions from anyone on this? No? Okay. All right, then we'll go ahead. The Board Finance Committee recommends that the self-workers' compensation renewal premium payment for fiscal year 16 be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Great, thank you. The prevailing wage resolution, which again is an annual resolution.
Yes.
Mary?
Sure. This is required of the board, and it's brought to the board every June for approval. And we do a joint publication between District 202 and District 65. We share the cost of the advertisement that runs in the newspapers. We are obligated to pay prevailing wage for certain types of functions, and this notice is a legal requirement, and again, it's just being done this time of year.
Any questions from anybody on the prevailing wage resolution? No? Good. All right. The Board Finance Committee recommends that the prevailing wage resolution for fiscal year 16 be presented to the full board on June 8, 2015. Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Okay. And then item 9 is our working cash fund transfer for fiscal year 16. Can you just explain what the working cash fund?
Sure, sure. We have a cash balance in our working cash fund, and we rely upon it heavily. This cash balance allows us to pay our bills for things like salaries, insurance coverage, other payments, until we receive our large influx of tax payments, which arrive in the fall. So we have a working cash fund transfer resolution that comes to the board every June, and with approval, this allows us to use that cash balance in the various funds as we have needs until those fall taxes arrive, at which point the working cash is paid back in full, the amounts borrowed from it.
Thank you. Good information. Okay, any questions about the working cash balance? No? All right. The Board Finance Committee recommends the working cash fund transfer FY16 be presented to full board also on June 8, 2015. Do I have a second?
Second. Yeah.
Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Okay, we've got two more. The next item is the transfer of interest from our debt service fund resolution.
Sure, this is a familiar resolution that comes in June as well. The debt service fund is the fund in which we receive tax payments for bond and interest payments that we need to make on our bond sales. So this is fund number 30. Just happens to be the fund number. And we do accrue a little bit of interest in that fund, a little over $7,500, and we can move it to the fund most in need. And the IMRF fund has the lowest cash balance at this point, so we realize it's a small amount of money, but we would like the permission to move that interest amount into the IMRF fund.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions? No? All right, I will state this. Resolution, the Board Finance Committee recommends that the transfer of interest from debt service fund resolution be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015.
Second.
Roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
OK, And our last item for, is the PMA resolution. PMA, can you just tell everybody what PMA is?
Sure. PMA serves as our financial advisors, and we also do a small amount of investing with the group as they pool resources from hundreds of districts in the state of Illinois. So they just asked us to bring an updated resolution to the board, which acknowledges them as our financial advisors.
Okay, thank you. So the board, oh, any questions? No. The Board Finance Committee recommends that the PMA resolution be presented to the full board on June 8th, 2015.
Second.
And roll call.
Ms. Chow?
Yes.
Mr. Rakus?
Yes.
Ms. Garrison?
Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for having read all these materials so we could move quickly through it. Appreciate that. So now we'll move on to our discussion items, with the first being the Lincoln School enrollment update. Peter, are you going to sure. speak to that?
Yeah. So I just wanted to bring you an update now that our first round of magnet school and permissive transfer lottery has occurred. As you know, the board approved back in May a class size limit for each grade level at Lincoln based on the number of classrooms that would be serving each grade and the district class size limits. After the first round lottery, we ended up with 65 students in kindergarten at Lincoln in the general education classrooms and two in the self-contained classrooms, which is a total of 67, falling far below the 92 that we have space for. And therefore, we will not be proceeding with the lottery for kindergarten that the board had approved, which is really good news for the families at Lincoln. The families who chose seats at other schools in the district, along with families who have not yet registered, will be allowed to continue to register into those seats on a first-come, first-served basis. And when we reach 92, if we should, we will then work with families to find alternative magnet school or neighborhood school seats for their children. Currently, there are a number of seats available at both King Lab and at Bessie Rhodes, and so we should be in pretty good shape. In the other grade levels, there are between 12 and 24 seats available. So again, we will fill these on a first-come, first-served basis. And if all goes well over the course of the summer, which is a little hard to predict, we may have a situation where we can provide a seat at Lincoln to all those who are looking for one and not have to work with anybody to find an alternative location.
Great. Thank you very much. Are there questions? Comments anyone has
how many kindergarten parents elected or got selected for magnet? What was the number? Because those would have been the ones that potentially would have pushed us to the 92, right? If yeah. not going to the program.
So there were 100 when we ran the lottery, there were 114 kindergarten students registered who lived within the Lincoln attendance boundaries. So almost half of the people enrolled selected a seat elsewhere in the district.
So does this mean this will be the process going forward year after? I mean, is this the new norm? Because next year we potentially would be bumping up against this again.
So I think it's a little hard to know. What I'd like to do is wait until the fall to see how many people from that attendance area are enrolled. And we had indicated to you all and to the folks in the Lincoln community that in the fall we would be looking at some longer term solutions. So I think we need to see where does that enrollment fall in the fall in order to know, you know, are we dealing with something that continues to go up, something that's flat, or something that's going down in terms of our overall enrollment numbers. If you look at the total here, we have, right now, 525 students who are enrolled at Lincoln, which is significantly lower than the number that are there today, and certainly a lot lower than the 630 that we had originally projected. So what might be the new normal for a while is to be very generous in the number of Lincoln students that we accept in transfers, and we may have to wait and see a little bit to know whether we need to have another situation where we really encourage folks to apply for those transfers.
I also think it's interesting to watch the numbers from today through the August registration period. So we'll have points to be able to say, based on what we've done so far, what happens in the late summer rush, and that will help us prepare for the following year.
And you're thinking what I'm wondering. I know you weren't here at this point last year, Peter. Do we know how many students we had registered at this point at Lincoln a year ago?
I don't have that number. Yeah. What I know that many students do enroll over the summer, particularly in Southeast Evanston, which is a popular neighborhood for folks to move to from Chicago when their children become kindergarten age. I also would anticipate that some of the folks who accepted seats in other schools may choose to transfer back to Lincoln now that they know that there are seats available, which we announced in the letter that we gave to all the kindergarten families.
Thanks.
So of the 20, there's 16 kindergarteners at King Arts and 12 at Bessie Rhodes. Are all of those folks from attendance area of Lincoln? I mean, did we 100% take those applicants? Because
we accepted all applicants from Lincoln, but we also accepted applicants from other attendance areas.
Okay.
So if you lived in the Lincoln attendance area, this year we chose to accept everyone because we didn't know what percent would say yes. And a larger percent said yes than I had anticipated. But we also accepted folks from other attendance areas into the magnet schools.
And then some of the students who would have gone to Lincoln, they didn't just go to the magnet schools. I assume some went to
Tweed, permissive transfers. There were many schools that they applied to.
So then what does that do, though, for the magnet school? So I'm assuming the majority of them went to one of the two magnet schools.
That's correct.
If you're saying that there's going to be people who now go back to Lincoln knowing that there are some spaces, mm-hmm. and then we open up the, are we maxed out at the magnet schools, or there's still space? Okay, so it hasn't affected other people who wanted to get into the magnet schools from non-Lincoln.
That's right. And just as in previous years, we run a lottery every month during the summer. So if many families from Lincoln choose to return to the magnet schools, we'll be able to offer additional seats at the magnet schools to folks from other attendance areas who at this point we had said no to. And the way that we do that is we look at the average class size of the schools where folks are coming from, and the schools that are a bit fuller at kindergarten, we select more students. The schools that have fewer kindergartners, we would select fewer students.
So Peter, there are no wait lists currently.
At Lincoln?
At Rhodes or at...
There are students who applied for the magnet schools who did not receive a seat or an offer of a seat during the first round lottery.
So that'll happen, that's the subsequent lotteries over the each month.
That's right.
What's the date by when the final determinations are made? I know historically families sometimes scramble the week right before school. What's the planned date this year to know where students will be attending? Because running the various lotteries that you do during the summer.
I don't have the date with me. Our next lottery will be June 11th. We'll run one again in July and one in August. So I could certainly share that out in terms of the date of the final. We also then have folks who come and register right at the beginning of school, but obviously those folks won't be going to magnet schools.
Omar?
It's semi-related, but I'm gonna ask it anyway. So how is the lottery actually conducted? And I have people ask me this all the time. And I'll just tell you, in my own mind, I assume we do random drug tests. It's the same way everyone has a slot. A computer program runs it and it kicks out names, and those are the people who are selected. Mm-hmm. So can you just tell us how the lottery?
Yeah, so it works very much like that. The factors that we take into account in terms of, so it's not just a random selection of everybody goes in a hat, but it is a selection of everybody within a specific group goes in a hat. And the groups are based on what school the students are coming from. So across D65, we have schools like Lincoln, where lots and lots of students were accepted because the school is crowded. And we also have schools that don't have a crowding problem at all. And so the lottery is weighted, so your number is more likely to come up if you live in a neighborhood where the neighborhood school has more crowding issues. And the other thing that we take into account is having gender parity so that we don't end up pulling all boys to be in the kindergarten at King Arts and all females to be in the kindergarten at Bessie Rhodes or something like that.
But with those weights, it's all computer generated.
That's right.
It's not a real hat.
It's not a real hat.
Just to clarify Omar's question about lottery, is sibling also a group? Like, is there a sibling preference to keep families together?
That's right. So there is a sibling preference. Thank you for reminding me of that. And what that essentially means is that if you have a sibling in the school, you will be the first person pulled. And the reason for that preference is so that families don't have to go around the city dropping students off in multiple locations.
And actually, we have a board policy, I think, that lays out really specifically which elements have priority and such.
That's right.
If anyone is interested to read that.
Does anybody else have questions? I just had two other ones. One was, I had read, and I think it was in the memo for the district-wide, that June 9th would be the date that anybody who hasn't re-enrolled would be...
Withdrawn?
Withdrawn, yeah, that's the terminology. So just wondering, what does that mean as far as if I'm withdrawn, what's the consequence? What process do I then need to go through as a parent to re-register? Is it different, et cetera? Mm-hmm.
So if you are withdrawn, and I should note that the only folks who will be withdrawn are those who have not turned in their re-registration and proof of residence after concerted follow-up both by us and the schools. So folks generally have been contacted both by my department several times by phone and email, and also by the school in a lot of cases. We've sent lists on several occasions to the schools for the folks there to follow up as well. Mm-hmm. So if you fall into a category where you've not yet turned in your re-registration paperwork, we will withdraw the student. And so at that point, the student would have to enroll as a new student. Logistically for a parent, what that would mean is that you would have to go onto the District 65 website and fill out the new student registration form and turn in your proof of residence. If the student has already been enrolled here, you wouldn't have to do the one thing that requires you to actually come to the district office, which is to show the birth certificate. We would already have that on file. But we would have to see proof of residence, which folks can send to us either through our website or over email.
Okay, so it doesn't necessitate them to come physically here.
That's correct.
Richard.
Yeah.
I'm curious, I think we talked, and actually the Lincoln community supported having everybody re-register at Lincoln, and I'm wondering, do we know the result of that? I mean, is that a factor that might be driving down some of the numbers that we've seen? I'm just curious, because we had talked at one point about doing that district-wide, and I sort of saw this as a potential pilot test to see if it was actually identifying families that don't live in the district that were attending our schools. Any insights on that?
So I don't have insights yet, but I think I have a timeline on which we will know the insights. Every year there are students who don't show up on the first day of school. And so I think when we talk about who has re-registered, there are those people who have not re-registered because they may have lived outside the district and now they're not able to produce the proof of residence. There are also folks who would not re-register because they're planning to move out of Evanston or Skokie over the summer anyway. So once we have the data about who comes back in the fall, it'll give us a sense of how this year's data compares to previous year's data. And if we see that there are fewer people returning from one year to the next by grade level at Lincoln, I think it would give us some indication that maybe the re-registration has had some effect.
And you're just getting to what made me think about that in looking at the numbers of non-kindergarten classes and where we are today versus, you know, where some of those classes are right now. It looked like there was probably a drop for almost every grade level. And
yes,
that might, I'll be very interested to hear what insights you have, because it's something that I've got my eye on that we could consider for the whole district.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think it's a good point. There are two things about these numbers that are different than what we would have seen in the past. So one is that during this school year, our ESL program at Lincoln has not accepted new students. And the ESL students at Lincoln tend to be more likely to move in or out of the school during the course of the school year than other students at Lincoln. And so today's numbers are lower than the beginning of the year's numbers, mm-hmm, or at this time compared to previous years, because of that change to the ESL program enrollment. The second thing that's different here is that we have students who enroll over the summer. So the best comparison is going to be the beginning of this school year's enrollment to the beginning of last school year's enrollment. And if that's quite different, and we look at who's not returning, those two things I think can answer the question that you're asking.
Mm-hmm. Is that something we can make sure is finds its way into a finance agenda,
sure,
in the fall based on whatever timing, mm-hmm, would be appropriate?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
I
have a few questions. Do we know how many non-kindergartners, you know, those students who are first through fifth, how many students who moved so that the numbers were reduced? How many were dropped because during the re-registration they'd moved and so they couldn't re-register at Lincoln?
You mean they moved within District 65?
Correct. So it's not that they moved out of District 65, that they moved within District 65, so now they really should be going to another school. Do we know that number?
I'm sure that in the analysis that you're looking for, that I can pull that information together.
And do we know how many students have not re-registered yet, first through fifth or K?
I don't have that
four.
Number with me, but we do know that.
Okay, and then the last number is, it looks like there's 21 self-contained students, is, mm-hmm, that? So are those, because my understanding is that there's going to be two self-contained classrooms, are those going to still be, so that would be 8 in K-2? Can you tell me about those two classrooms? Do we have information yet?
So I think Joyce Bartz would be the best one to answer the question. And unfortunately, she's not with us right now. I know that she and her supervisors have been planning carefully for this.
Okay.
So I wouldn't want to speak on their behalf, but
yeah,
I know they've been thinking about it.
Okay.
So we can follow up and try to get that information for you.
Great.
Meg.
She's just walking.
It was magic.
Joyce, we have a question for you.
I don't think she heard.
Joyce.
Oh, yes.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing.
I have a question for you. Would you mind stepping up? Sorry. So while she gets settled, Meg, could you re-ask the question?
Do you have information about the self-contained classrooms yet, the class sizes yet of those?
We're speaking about Lincoln.
The two self-contains?
I was just looking at Lincoln, at these numbers. Do I have the sizes? I don't know the sizes of them at this moment.
Okay.
We're still in ICU.
So these particular numbers could change then, Peter, from what I'm hearing?
Yeah, so there's two pieces, right? The just like the general education, there's moving. And then, as Joyce mentioned, she's continuing to work on IEPs.
So these might be the limits then? Or we're not sure yet.
No.
We'll come back to that.
With every 10 students, you add an aide. And so there can be a limit of 10 at elementary, 15 at middle.
Thank you.
So I will note that we'll come back to, in the fall, talking about the impact of the re-enrollment on a broader scale, and then, and the couple questions that Meg had said about non-registered and those moved. Peter, can you follow up with that?
Yep.
And then I thought, since we are here, before we go on to the next thing, if there was an FYI about district-wide enrollment, if anyone has any really important questions that they wanted to raise around that, while Peter's still, not that you need to leave, Peter, but we could get rid of it all in one fell swoop, as opposed to going on. So were there any, did folks have questions? They don't, I did. Okay, I'll start with myself. I had two questions, I think, and one of them was, just for your general take, there were in the detail you had highlighted some classrooms and flagged them, and I'm just wondering for an overall take on whether you think there are any particular classrooms or places where there are hotspots that we should be aware of that you're tracking closely, Peter, and the team, and if so, what options or alternatives you're thinking about relative to those particular hotspots, meaning they may go over enrollment or under, I suppose, too.
Right. So actually, at this point, there isn't any place that I'm particularly worried about. Okay. There are a couple of classrooms, if you were to look through the detail, where class size is starting to get to 21 or 22. Mm-hmm. I discussed that with Laura Tyra, who's been doing this work for the district for a number of years. She didn't have concerns about those, and the reason is that we have applications to the magnet schools yet from those schools that we haven't accepted. And so it's very likely that through the additional rounds of lottery that happen over the summer, that those couple of cases where we have more students can be handled in that way.
Okay, great. And then the other question I had, and it's kind of on the tail of the discussions that we had this past year around TWEE class size and compliance there, that TWEE classes are 90% of the gen ed class. Mm-hmm. Just clarifying whether that is kindergarten only or if that rule runs through all grades, because there's some non-kindergarten classes that are certainly larger, the TWEEs are larger than the gen ed. So
the requirement is that we be in compliance at all grade levels. However, in the course of discussing the finding with the state, the plan was to start with kindergarten. And this year we started with Oakton for the current school year, and next school year we'll be at all of the sites. And so what we need to do is get our kindergarten classrooms at 90% of the general ed average class size. And then as those students age, we will be able to maintain that 90% ratio for the TWEE classrooms.
Okay, all right, great, thank you.
And we have to regularly adjust to make sure that we're in compliance, and we've had to do this year at Oakton as well.
Mm-hmm. So Claudia, you're looking at me like, the context of that was we had had a much longer discussion previously around the fact that there's a state regulation that TWEE classes, or bilingual classes in general, doesn't have to be TWEE, but bilingual classes should be 90% the number enrollment of whatever the general ed is.
My quizzical look was actually, how did we adjust?
We had in the particular case of Oakton, we had one family that moved out and we were actually out of compliance, so we did not fill that position with somebody who wished, with any of the families who might have wished to fulfill that. Fill that position.
If that hadn't have happened, would we have done anything, or would we have just been? I mean, because you've got a student in a class and it's halfway through the year, and we find we're out of compliance. It just.
Would we have done anything? No, we would have. We would have sustained the child in the class.
Okay.
So. I mean, similarly, that's the logic behind why we're not reducing the number of fourth graders.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Once a student has entered the TWEE program, despite being out of compliance, what we will do is can allow those students to complete the TWEE program and manage to come into compliance based on new students who are entering the program.
Just to clarify the compliance requirement, At every point during the school year, do we need to be in compliance, or it's just the start of the year enrollment?
It's the start of the year enrollment.
Okay.
The compliance issue is that your enrollment policy is as designed. So I think the ISB understands that children move and children come in and come out, but that your policy is as designed target a 90% or less.
Okay. That seems more realistic. All right.
Yeah.
Thank you for both of those clarifications. Are there, anyone else have anything on the enrollment, the district-wide enrollment piece? No? Okay. Thank you very much, Peter.
Sure.
Okay, we'll move on to the very important discussion around budgets. I think the first item is speaking of our unaudited actuals for fiscal 15 and then also the draft tentative budget.
Yes, tonight we have a brief presentation first of the projected actuals for operating funds. And then high-level discussion of our draft tentative budget for next year. In-depth discussion with all the materials and documents will take place in our August finance meeting. So this is on just the presentation on the high level, and I will try to highlight the most important things, and I understand that we don't have much time, so I'll be brief. I would like to start with page 54, which has a table. Which illustrates our revenues, our operating revenues by category and expenditures, and it compares the adopted budget for the current year with projected actuals. And I just want to stress out that the projected column is not final. We still have 1 month to go, so these numbers will look slightly different. But overall, when you look at the total revenue line, you can see that the district is projecting to collect 100% of the revenues. And this is actually unusual. Normally, we collect 98%, 99%. We are projecting to collect 100% this year. Same thing on the revenue side. We are projecting to spend 100% revenue expenditures of our 106.6 budget. So so let me just briefly explain what is up and what is down. Property taxes, we have been very lucky this year. The collection for our fall taxes, which is the 2013 levy, is over our collection rate by approximately $700,000. Which is great. Corporate personal property replacement tax also at 101%, slightly over by $23,000. Other local revenues, which includes things like interest income, fees, TIF surplus payments, is slightly down, primarily of lower than projected lunch sales. General state aid at 100% projected. State aid categorical, which includes things like state grants and state reimbursements, bilingual, early childhood, transportation, orphanage, and so on, is projected to be slightly under budget. And the budget only included three payments. We got three of them. But it's very difficult to budget for this line, so it's never on target. We get a lot of reimbursements for prior years, which are based on students, services provided to students, personnel for special education services, and these are very fluent populations. So these numbers are never 100%. Federal aid, 98%, $158,000 under budget. Primarily due to a grant for which we applied, Safe Route to School grant, but we never executed. Requirement for that grant was they were very difficult and complicated, and we never spent anything, and we never got any revenues. We had this grant on both sides, so it's a wash, but it was never executed, and we just, that's why the revenues are under budget. And it was close to 100,000. Transfers, this is interest income. We had a resolution earlier on about this very thing. This is interest income earned on debt service fund balance that is being transferred every year to the fund of our choosing, IMRF fund. And we actually are seeing a very positive trend. Interest are rising. Probably for the first time in 6 years, we're seeing interest income exceeding the budget, which is a great thing for us, for a school district. On the expenditure side, we are projecting salaries to end slightly under budget, 99%. We are seeing lower expenditures for our substitute cost, and I'm talking about per diem substitutes. We are seeing less expenditures for certain stipends, and I'm talking about what we budgeted at the beginning of the year. Also, certain positions that we had in our budget were filled mid-year, or they were filled with agency personnel, which are sitting in a different line in purchase services. So that's why you see underspent expenditures for salaries. In the benefit line, a little different situation. We actually are projecting to overspend by 1% by $64,000. We had additional expenditures for federal, TRS federal, and this is basically administrative cost, a penalty on any salary paid from federal grants. Basically, on every dollar that we get from federal government, we have to pay 35 cents to the state for managing the grants. And so in the prior years, we actually have fewer certified staff paid, but this grant can be adjusted after the budget, and I think was adjusted after the budget was approved. That's why there is a discrepancy between the budget and actual expenditures. Purchase services, we are projecting additional expenditures over budget by 2% or $220,000. And this is intentional. We are spending we have additional expenditures due to park testing. We actually had additional wiring expenditures, additional buildings and grounds expenditures. That explains that variance. Supplies and materials, 100% is being projected. Capital outlay, another area where we overspent, and again, this is by design as well, by 200,000 or 123%. Again, park testing related expenditures, we had to buy projectors. We had to buy network switches and access points. I'm not even sure what that is, but these expenditures were not in the budget. We had to rewire basically all the buildings, right, to conduct this test. I don't know, Joe, if you want to speak a little bit more about these expenditures.
When we did the infrastructure trial for Park in January, we noticed that there was some droppage of devices while we did the infrastructure trial, so we had to actually add more access points throughout the schools. The projectors, there was 200 projectors that were slated to be bought this next year coming up, and we dropped that down to 125 now because we had to buy an additional 75 because the oldest projectors we have in the schools, they're about going on 8 years old, and the bulbs were burning out. To replace the bulb is going to be about $400. So, but we were going to place those projectors anyway because eventually they're going to go out. So that's why we bought more projectors as far as that line item there. We did save money though on consulting services and other line items to move that money there.
So is that what's referenced as instructional equipment?
Yes, okay. Yes. And we have been reporting to the committee about this particular category of expenditures being over the budget. It is reported with April expenditures in the packet, so as the expenditures were taking place.
I have a question on the same thing. So you're saying that in capital outlay, this was really related to park testing?
Yes.
Yeah, it might have been helpful just to say that, rather than just saying that it was for instructional equipment, because to know specifically, because is that would be kind of like a one-time?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, once the access points are set in the classrooms, they stay there.
Exactly, so that would have been nice to know that that was specifically because of Park.
And to be clear, those devices enabled Park testing, but they also enable faster wireless bandwidth in the school for lots of other purposes.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll be used for many other things.
Oh, well, I know that when you make a change to a classroom and it's there, I mean, that's obvious, but I just, it would have been helpful. I just think it would have been interesting to note that.
The rest of the categories, other objects tuition, which includes special education tuition and the net cost of Park School and termination benefits are projected to be spent at 100%. So overall, we were projecting $135,000 surplus, and currently we are projecting surplus to be a little bit higher, $600,000, again, due to these, primarily due to these additional revenues. Are there any questions about the current year? And again, these will be revised once all the transactions for the year are in. For the next presentation of the actuals.
I have a couple questions.
Sure.
The amount that we pay subs, the rate we pay subs, or what, does that go into salaries? Is that
yes,
where we find that?
Yes.
And I'm wondering if we're looking to, I understand that we pay less than surrounding districts for substitute teachers, and we've had a hard time getting substitute teachers. Is that correct?
That's correct.
That's correct. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if we're looking at next year's budget, if we're thinking about raising that at all, if that's going to be a factor in next year's budget.
Fiscal year 16.
Mm-hmm.
We have not, as of this tentative draft, raised the rate. And so we need to take the question and mm-hmm. consider it and consider the cost ramifications.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then this is a factual thing. Just remind me what the IDEA grant is.
It's the Individual with Disabilities Educational Act.
Special
education.
Okay, that's
federal
a federal grant?
Federal.
Okay. And I think that's it, yeah, for me.
Okay. Anybody else have anything on the current year? No, okay. Let's move to fiscal year 16.
Moving on to the fiscal year 16 draft budget, and what I left on the tables are the very same tables that are in your packet, but they are stapled together. Page that has a summary of operating funds, as well as the updated financial projections. And again, these are not any different than what you saw in your packet. That's just, I think, will be easier to have them next to each other. I just want to proceed with the numbers, if this is okay with you, Candace.
Sure, please.
Okay. So the page has the same layout. The information that we present is done in the way that state requires us to do, and we use the same categories as required by the Illinois Accounting Manual. In terms of revenues and expenditures. This page includes adopted budget for fiscal year 15, projected actuals, and tentative budget. Revenues are projected to increase 2% from unaudited actuals, from projected actuals. We always compare budget to actuals, never budget to budget. On the revenue side, property taxes, which include fiscal year 14 and 15 levies, increasing by 2%. We did receive some good news in terms of new property. It is going to be a little bit higher than what we had in projections. We did not get the final number yet. It's going to come in August, but we know it's going to be approximately $200,000 more, and it is embedded in the numbers. New property also includes the expiration of the Southwest TIF, which expired with the 2014 levy. Corporate personal replacement tax is projected to increase by 2.5%. other local revenues is going to be smaller in comparison with our actuals, primarily due to the absence of TIF surplus payment that we received last year. It was approximately $400,000. That payment came from the city of Evanston in July. We do not have intergovernmental agreement with the city. I know Mary is working with Mr. Stafford from 202 and with Mr. Lyons on getting money from the city, but at this point, we did not feel comfortable including that payment in the numbers. So that's what explaining the decrease from actuals. General state aid, again, lack of information on the final budget from the state. Both House and the Senate passed their versions of the budget, which actually have a small increase for K-12 education, but it's very unlikely that it's gonna be signed by the governor. So until we get a final budget from the state, we using the previous assumptions for our state revenues, which is basically 98% proration for GSA and 4 payments for state categoricals. State categoricals are increasing by 17%, primarily because the budget includes 4 payments. Last year included only 3 payments. The first payment was received in the prior fiscal year. So that's why you see a big increase, 17%. Again, it's because of the timing. Federal aid, 2% increase, nothing unusual there. The new Head Start grant for which we applied, we haven't received a final decision, so we don't feel comfortable including it in the numbers, but if we do get it, it's gonna be included in the tentative budget in August. Transfers, which is an interest income on debt service fund, 20%, and it's, even though the percentage is large, it's only $1,000. Again, the interests are rising, which is good. Any questions about revenues? Okay, moving to expenditures.
Oh, I do have one, which is, what you think the likelihood of getting an intergovernmental agreement is?
Well, last time we did not have an intergovernmental agreement and the city still gave us the money. So I actually feel that the chances are probably high.
What we received in this current year was a TIF surplus payment, something a little bit different from a TIF agreement payment. If a TIF is doing extremely well, as they have it with Evanston, a lot of cash builds up and they have been able to make TIF surplus payments. So that was not anything they really would have put into an agreement, but they did make a payment to us last year. We don't know if we're likely to be, you know, receiving a payment in next year. Again, Bill Stafford and I have had some initial conversations with the city and Marty Lyons. The city even benefits when they're able to do a TIF surplus payment because they're one of the parties that gets part of the payment. It is paid actually not in the form of a check, but through property tax distributions. It comes from the Cook County Clerk's office as a separate coded revenue source. So, you know, we're certainly pursuing a TIF surplus payment, but that would have been outside of a typical TIF agreement.
Does a TIF agreement hit their operating budget, or where does that source from?
I'm not quite sure if it comes from a TIF surplus, because TIF surplus is different from a TIF payment.
They do budget
because that is an expense that they would make, and they have made those in the form of an actual check that comes from the city. So that is different from a TIF surplus.
The likelihood of a TIF agreement, given the financial concerns of the city, just like the financial, is probably less than a surplus.
That is correct. I think it's more likely that we could receive a TIF surplus payment.
That's it.
Okay.
Sure. And this might actually kick into the budget task force, but there's, where do, are you anticipating any other grants federal or non-federal?
In next
year's budget?
At this point, no.
No.
Well, we, except for the Head Start, we're just waiting for the information.
Waiting for the federal Head Start.
So we can include the revenues in our budget and corresponding.
But any other private grants that are anticipated at this point?
We have a tentative grant from the Noyce Foundation to do work in STEM learning ecologies. That's going to have less of an impact on staffing within the budget as it is to be able to give us some creative resources to work with members of the community. So that's tentative as well.
And we have a grant manager position that was created a few months ago, so I'm sure she's going to be looking actively for new revenue sources, so we could get one after the budget is approved. We actually have funds in our budget. They are called grant holding accounts, $150,000 for the state and $150,000 for federal, and that's what we use it for. I mean, we basically take the money, we transfer to a grant, and we create a program.
Right. And but so the answer is right now there isn't there is anything nothing. Incremental budgeted, yes. So it would be.
And I there think. Is a placeholder eventually
yes.
as a line item for where that
Correct.
Would go if you had it.
Correct.
Yes. Okay.
I did have one other question. This is the table on page 60. And it was in other local revenue, which shows that our unaudited actuals are 208% above the budget. And then they go back down for next year. I'm just wondering what that was.
I'm sorry, which line?
This is on page 60 of the packet we were sent. Okay. And it's other local revenues, budgeted at $4.3 million, actually $9.3 million.
Yes, that line includes bond sales. We never budget for bond sales,
okay.
but when they do come in, they are included in that line. And this is part of non-operating fund. The proceeds are deposited into okay. fund 64 or 65. We have.
So does it always fluctuate that much just because we never budget for them?
I mean, yes.
we always see
yes.
this and okay. Mm-hmm.
So for those who are coming in, we're still in our finance meeting, just so you know that you're entering the finance meeting, and we'll hope to be complete this soon so we can move to the special board meeting. I just want to make sure everybody knew kind of where they were and what they were entering.
Good idea.
It's first time doing this, so.
Okay, moving on to expenditures.
Yes.
Are projected to increase by 3%. Next year will be the final year of the employee contracts. This amount of $77.8 million includes budget balancing strategies, which had 29 positions, which were eliminated through attrition or reorganization. It also has 2.5 additional instructional positions. Retirements and the cost of retirements, although the full savings from retirements are not realized until, will not be realized until fiscal year 17. And employee benefits are projected to increase by 18%. Now, medical and dental costs are increasing by 5%. The reason why the total cost is increasing by 18% is because next fiscal year has 12 payments. The current year had 11 payments. We do a lot of creative things to manage, to balance our budgets. I mean, this is one of those things, but no, our benefits are not increasing by 18%. It's just the cost when you compare one year to another. Purchase services, a decrease by 15%. Again, a budget balancing strategies of approximately 470. And also a lot of things are not included. A lot of items are not included, such as workers' compensation premium, because we are paying it now for next year. Property liability insurance, not included. RMR contract, not included. It will be paid from the surplus this year. Supplies and materials are also projected to decrease by 10%. This line does have one new item, approximately $200,000 for curriculum materials for grades K through 3. I don't know, John, if you want to say something about this new expenditure. Was part of our budget balancing strategies. Also, the current year had a lot of one-time expenditures, social study adoption. These expenditures are not in next year's numbers.
The literacy curriculum materials that are in the budget will be planned by, in a collaborative process and working across the district as we develop our K-3 instructional framework. And so we've got money to put behind that to purchase materials when that group makes a decision about how to best move forward to serve our students in our district.
And what subject area?
Literacy.
And that's for 15-16 or 16-17?
It's no, it's budgeted in 15-16, but would be implemented in 16-17.
So the materials that are budgeted for 15-16 really won't be in the classrooms until 16-17?
That's right. Correct. By the time we go through a process and make those decisions.
Moving on to capital outlay, there is a big decrease of 69%, but it's actually just going back to the previous levels of expenditures for capital outlay. Again, last year included several one-time expenditures related to park testing. Other objects, tuition and transfers, typically there is a 10% increase. That's the special education tuition park school. There is a 2% decrease because certain students who are in the out-of-district placements will be moved to Rice Center next year. I'm not sure, Joyce, if we have a final number, if we have that finalized, but I think we were talking about 8 to 12 possibly students.
We were discussing 8 to 12 students that would be coming back from private day. Those going to Rice will be less than that, maybe about 4 or 5.
So we may be adjusting this number in the tentative budget and or in the final budget. Termination benefits, a 2% increase, and overall we are projecting a surplus of approximately $1.1 million. If you remember back in February, we were talking about a surplus in the amount of 1.7. Well, that is not going to happen, obviously, because there were adjustments to state revenues, and also there is a very large increase to our transportation services that we did not anticipate, over 21%, which translates to almost $500,000 in new expenditures. So that obviously is decreasing our surplus, which will be used, and that's why I stapled the second sheet. If you look at our projections, the surplus will be used to prepay certain expenditures, and to be specific, workers' compensation, property liability, and I'm referring to line 24 on the financial projection sheet that's stapled to
The 980.
Yes, and The amount of prepayment is slightly lower because our premiums have dropped. So that amount was over $1 million in previous projections. We are prepaying the same things. We are prepaying workers' compensation, property liability insurance, and RMR, but it's going to cost us a little bit less.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Kathy, but this 988.50 reflects prepayments that would be made next year off the surplus.
Correct.
From 16.
Yes.
Not the prepayments we were just discussing previously.
That's right.
So it's
that's
additional.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And indeed, by making those payments, as we look in the out years, so we look in 16, 17, 17, 18, 18, 19, we take what are projected deficits and we do our best to address them as we move forward. While we still face uncertainty, I think one of the things that's underlying all this is that we don't have a state budget and we don't know exactly what the legislature and the governor are going to be doing with their next steps.
And none of those things presume things go away. We're just effectively paying for it. It's a timing.
Correct.
We're not reducing any of those services or programs.
Correct.
I have a question because we did go through a painful, there are choices that are always hard to make, and we had reductions in force for next year.
Mm-hmm.
And if we hadn't made those, what would have been our position ending up the year? Do we know?
Well, there were just personnel reductions. We're close to 1.6 million with benefits. So I think we would still have a deficit this year.
If we hadn't made them, we would have been a much higher deficit
in subsequent years. Deficit that we were projecting in February was close to 6 million. And here we have a couple things reducing this deficit. I mean, we have these budget balancing strategies that are included in subsequent years because they are not in next year. And again, next year's are based on the tentative budget. But we will be able to do prepayments. So we will be reducing expenditures for fiscal year 17 by prepaying these things, by removing them from expenditures.
And Claudia, your question, the 1.6 million would have been resources for staff members. And then we made about $900,000 of reductions of non-personnel costs. So it's about $2.5 million of reductions that are embedded into this roadmap for the future that still shows deficits in 16, 17, and beyond.
Okay.
And when we've made any other changes, we've done so in a cost-neutral way so that we can fulfill the needs that we have in the strategic plan, but stay at what I call cost-neutral, which means not adding cost to the district.
Jennifer, I think, has a question.
Relative to last week's vote on using debt service extension base for the technology lease, and that there's agreement, I think, that it'd be good practice eventually to, yes, the district needs to buy technology, but to be having those expenditures come out of the operating budget, not out of the debt service extension base. And so looking at the capital outlay, if we don't need to, that was a four-year lease, but thinking about FY 18, 19, 19, 20, when the deficits are getting larger, and thinking about, if you needed to renew a four-year lease, that's about a $380,000, $400,000 annual payment that needs to come out of capital outlay. I just want to flag that because it felt like there was agreement on that. That's why I voted no on it. But I think hopefully we can flag that. So it's a long-term problem, but if we don't flag it now, then our likelihood of changing it later gets harder.
And your point is well taken that best practice is to pay for those expenditures out of our operating budget, not out of our debt service.
So I think that's also one of the things that the budget task force
correct
would be considering as we start to charge them and start, how might that happen?
Good segue.
But I don't think Kathy's quite done.
I just have one point to make that the numbers do include the pension cost shift. It's approximately 350,000 next year, and then close to 700,000. It's about 650 in fiscal year 17. So if that legislation does not pass, these numbers will change. They will be lower.
But it's also at a percentage.
Or they could be used if something happens with the tax freeze legislation, for example. It could be used to help us with the shortfalls with state revenues.
It could very possibly be that the shift is higher than what we're anticipating as well, though, right? So we are leaving that in there now to be conservative.
It's hedging against the uncertainties that we're facing with pension or other places within the budget.
And I just wanted to also call everyone's attention, as well as those who might be looking at the packets, just to the point that Dr. Bourne had made. Attachment B in one of the in the packet is the non-personnel FYI 16 reduction. One of the commitments we've made in our strategic plan around transparency and communication of budget changes is to communicate kind of very clearly what are the trade-offs we're making in these budget reductions or budget management. And so it outlines each of, you've seen the personnel related reductions and that's there as well, but this has not been communicated previously. So I wanted to draw folks' attention to that in each of the categories, to the number that Dr. Gornan said it's just under $900,000. One general question I just did want to pose related to that is, you know, of these reductions, is there any way to characterize what are we losing from a programmatic or capability or capacity standpoint that we might want to make sure that folks here and elsewhere know, you know, these are choice, these are not personnel choices, but they too have potentially programmatic implications. And I thought, I first gravitated to the professional development related reductions because they clearly have, you know, programmatic related potentially. But are there, is there anything particularly here that jumps out that, that could relate to something that is meaningful to us, you know, other than being a line item in a budget for purchase services? Does anyone?
My take, you're right about professional development and professional learning. We also reduce in repairs and maintenance. And again, that's something that's actually really key in maintaining our buildings and maintaining our facilities. And so, again, it's seemingly small in a $100 million plus budget, but it's also, it could have a ramification on the way we offer our buildings to the public.
And I'm not trying to assert that we may be doing things differently and better.
Correct.
But you know, it's good to also be aware if you cut $100,000 in repairs and maintenance, just that everybody knows we're cutting $100,000. There could be possible impacts of that, and they're very real cuts. So, so if anyone, you know, just so folks know in the public that that's available and it details those reductions. And I wanted to thank both of you and the entire team, especially, you know, the precision that we have in these forecasts, especially in the last year, the budget projections relative to our actuals is pretty amazing. And so we know that doesn't come easily. It seems like it's easy to us when we review it, but it does not come easily. It comes with a lot of work and a lot of expertise, not only from those who are managing the budget, but from those who are actually administering the budget. So on behalf of the Finance Committee, I want to thank you all for that. Are there any other questions? We will be returning to this in August, with a more detailed presentation related to the budget.
We'll introduce some new documents in the spirit of transparency, so including budget at a glance.
Okay, so that was
a document.
Great, yes, thank you.
And in the interim, I may send out a note as well that sort of gives sort of an overview of where we've been and where we're going and how I see things. So that may be something that I can do over the next month and a half or two.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Okay, we're going to try to, we're 15 minutes over time. We have a few items still on the docket. The budget task force, there was a memo in the document. Is there anything?
Well, if I may, in lieu of the last conversation where we also see in the out years deficits that the district is facing and interesting and hard challenges as we move forward, upon advice of the board, I reached out to the Financial Sustainability Committee of the Strategic Planning Process, sent invitations out to ask if they would be willing to serve as members of a budget task force that would actually engage these sorts of conversations together with other members of the community. So I'm waiting for RSVPs, to be quite frank. Once we get that, we'll set up a process of meeting three or four times, potentially. We want to make sure we can fit within calendars, that we would reach out into the community so that as we move forward, if we have to make more budget reductions, that we're really reaching deeply into the community and engaging in that process. So invitations are out. We're waiting to get RSVPs. And I would argue that by August, when we reconvene, we'll have names and we'll have a process ready to go.
Great. Thank you. Transportation update to you too, Dr. Warren.
Transportation.
Oh, Mary. Sorry, didn't say that.
And I can start. We've been over the year concerned about our transportation services and indeed thinking about how we can build in efficiencies and move forward in ways that can serve our families and our children well and serve the concerns that we've had over transportation over the year. We initially sent out a note to the community saying we are contemplating making some some changes in routing and some changes in how we pick up. And in the deeper dive of our work, there's a lot of moving parts. There's a real deep desire to get the routes right and to make them more efficient. I should start with safety. Safety has to be number one. And we want to make sure that we're doing what we're doing with safety, driving it well. Communication has to get right as well in terms of communicating to parents who are dependent on busing and who have learned to become dependent on busing. Indeed, as we move forward on this, I've now suggested that we do our work in a systematic way to make sure that we get all the moving parts right, and so that we can move forward in a way that makes our system more efficient and more transparent to families. And that my worry was that we wouldn't be able to get that done on time by the beginning of the school year and communicate in a clear enough way that we'd have a lot more surprises than not. We're also in the midst of shifting management within our transportation department, and so I need to afford some time to be able to get that going as well. So with that, what Dr. Brown and I are working on, what Mary and I are working on, is the next level of how we would contemplate routing. We would then do some scenarios over the summer and then work through the fall and into the winter to work and engage our community on where there might be potential changes as we go forward. I think the other piece that is going to change a wee bit is that we're going to ask all families to apply for transportation before we've done assignments. And Mary, you might want to explain.
Sure. That. We are working on updating the transportation application form. In the past, we have asked only parents of magnet school students or students attending a TWE or ACC program to submit an application for transportation service. However, for 2015-16, we will be sending transportation applications to absolutely every student who is eligible for transportation services, and those forms need to be filled out and returned to us in order for us to include all eligible children on bus routes. If we do not get a completed form back, we will not be routing a child, and therefore bus stop information will not be getting out to families. So I do want to urge families interested in using the transportation services to please return those application forms as soon as possible. We're in the process of getting them updated in the hopes that we can get them out still possibly in the next week or so, and we'd like them back by the end of June so that we can work on routing students who plan to use the bus. So that is a change for next year, and it's a very important one that we communicate, and we will be communicating with those families throughout the summer.
Yes, Richard.
Just a couple things. First, I'm wondering if it might be good to frame it as a confirmation process, the way, as opposed to application, because application sounds like something that could be rejected. But since we're actually sending letters out to everyone who's eligible, if they respond, then we're just simply confirming that they want transportation services. Is that a fair way to frame it?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just we're an opt-in.
Opt-in.
Opt-in, something like that, so that people know they're not going to be waiting to see if they get it or not. If they return the letter, they will get it. The other thing I think is important is the board, I think, has expressed interest in making sure that we're looking at this population very carefully, those who are eligible, to make sure that we are not over purchasing the services of buses, so that as we try to manage our deficits, we're really applying an even more rigorous lens on this particular line item. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if everyone's aware of that, so I think it's worth restating.
Right.
And yes, this is just a quick question. It just surprised me that the number of total routes on the chart that you provided vary so much from month to month.
So the number of late bus, you mean?
Related to school days?
It could be related to the number of school days in a month. And the chart you're seeing is the number of late buses.
Well, there's number of late routes, and then it says number of total routes. And it, one month it could be 1,200.
Yes, August, of course, we had just a few days of school in August, and we would not have started activity routes before and after school. We would not have field trips taking place in late August, the first week of school.
So this is bus runs, really.
Bus runs.
Not routes. it's number of bus runs based on the number of days of school. That's why I was confused, because I thought of a route as the path the bus takes. This is actually the number of buses that go out and come back.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Let's see, what's on our screen? Oh, is it okay if we, the last item, the revenue and expenditures, can that be really fast?
I'll be really brief. I just wanted to let the board know, every month, the Board Finance Committee gets a very high-level overview of a month of the revenue and expenditure reports. It's a one-page summary. It's on page 84 and 85. And you can see the percent of budget collected to date. And there's a more detailed report of revenues and expenditures that's included in the treasurer's report that goes to the board. There's a little more detail there. So those are monthly reports on revenue and expenditure side. And that is what we use to track the budget month to month. And you can see what came in during the period, what percentage we are collected to date. So we just wanted to kind of alert you that they're there in the spirit of transparency.
Before we adjourn, I did want to call our attention to two things that were in the FYI. One is the EdRed State Finance Update. So for anybody in the audience or in the viewing audience, this is a document that's really very useful for folks to review. It outlines the ongoing uncertainty, but at least gives us a really good rundown of the various items that could impact our finances that are happening currently at the state level. So call that up to you for reference. And then in the technology plan update, we don't really have time to speak to this, but my question is, first, thank you for preparing that. It sounds like even from me speaking to folks at Evanston Public Library that there have been some really good conversations. So thank you for bringing those to fruition about how costs could be shared around some of these research resources and databases. And so I think that's wonderful, and the board had kind of asked for that, so it's a good update. Related to the questions that are here around the process for the technology update, my question to you, because there's some very specific things looking for feedback from the board, is it too late if this body includes a discussion around this at the August finance meeting? Or do you need feedback in advance of that? Was that work with the general time frame?
That'll be
Joe?
Fine.
Okay.
Yeah,
we can do all. So we'll put that on the agenda for August, and then we can circle back and have this time to read it in advance and
okay.
Thoughts. But I think at first blush, at least the outline speaks to what we've been discussing, and I think we have to just return to a discussion around, do we have the resources and bandwidth and the folks in place to be successful in this kind of endeavor to do a strategy plan in the time frame. So
and
we can
we're happy
discuss
to take feedback
August.
Along the way, individual
okay.
feedback.
So if anybody has any feedback in advance Absolutely. Of that, they can channel it to Paul, to yep. Dr. Boren, he'll get it to Joe and others. Okay, then.
Ken, so you're talking about the strategic plan process, the grid on
the
page 117.
The grid and the memo itself. In the okay. end of the memo, there's a couple questions. So the approach is really the Gantt or the modified Gantt chart mm-hmm. there. And then in the memo, there were some questions that we can discuss. Okay. Okay, if there's no other business before this meeting, I will adjourn us at 7:55 p.m.